So,
is it recording?
It's recording.
Oh, sweet.
So, this is OpenRocket. Does everyone have OpenRocket installed?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Okay. Oh, you don't have the computer with you?
No, but he's
going
to borrow mine, actually.
Okay.
Oh,
cool.
Oh, sorry. Well, there we go.
So, I think.
Yeah, I was try to
I think I'm just going
to
show putting together a rocket. And then show, like, looking at outputs later. So this stuff down here is going to be our little graphical view of the rocket. Over here is going to be, like, a little tree of the different components we have. And over here is going to be how we edit components. Well, add components. And I'll show you how to edit components later. So let's just start adding stuff, right? And I think I'm going to make it kind of a tiny size.
Oh,
seems like
imperial.
Oh, yeah.
Can you change that?
If you just want to do an individual unit, like say you're using a part and it just happens to be in metric, then you can just click on the unit and change it to something. I didn't realize they had 64ths of an inch. Yeah, so you can change all of your units if you go to Edit and Preferences, and then go to Units. You can change all your defaults. I have them in horrible mixed bastardized units.
Oh my God. That's American units, though. That's totally what it is.
Yeah, pretty much.
We basically go back and forth anyway.
Do you build these in calories?
Okay, I don't know where. Oh, no. That's not calories. That's calibers.
Yes.
We'll get to that later. Basically, I just use whatever's convenient rather than what's consistent.
Actually, what I thought when I looked at it was Calvin.
So you can see when I added the body tube, so a body tube is just a cylinder. It added something in the tree, and it added a little rectangle down here. And so let's make a rocket that's, say, a fin can, a tube, and a nose cone, right?
Okay.
That sounds reasonable. So we could add another body tube and make it, like, whatever crazy length we want. One alternative is I'm going to delete this so you can see which one in the little graphical view that it's highlighting, so mm-hmm. I can tell the difference between them. And I'll just delete it. And I want the exact same one, so I'm just going to Control C, Control V to copy paste it. And now I want a nose cone. So I'm going to click on this one, do nose cone. This is probably going to add it on not the end I want.
Nice.
Yeah, that's exactly what I want. Thanks, OpenRocket.
That's in Australia, though, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Rocket bell.
And let's make it a super simple nose cone. So we'll just make it conical. And let's make it exactly 6 and 3-inch base so it lines up with the rest of our rocket. That's going to put the center of pressure real far forward when we do it, but whatever.
Oh.
So it's on the back of our rocket. We don't want it there. So let's just drag it in the tree so it's on the front of the rocket.
Pointy and go forward.
Where were the kinds of rockets again? Like changing to canonical or conical?
So if I double click on the nose cone, it'll bring up my little editing box.
Mm-hmm.
In the nose cone shape drop down.
Hey, check out how.
You want to hear the hack series?
Check out how smart my system is. It changed the body size to the correct width for the nose cone.
That's pretty great. Does it give us a bunch of options for
like
hack?
It's like a little tiny tube. At the
it's a line.
Yeah, you must have it like automatically do it then.
So we could mess around with a bunch of nose cone shapes. But for the sake of, like, a hypothetical rocket that would be easy to build, let's do conical. Because that's, like, the simplest thing to manufacture, right?
For the most part, for your certs too, you want to look at, unless you want to make your own nose cones, it's easier just to buy like a nose cone somewhere.
Yeah.
So you'll just basically enter in whatever it is here.
I'm surprised they don't have an option for biconic. So yeah.
Okay, so like I'll leave them welcome later.
So for I would imagine for kits it's gonna be more straightforward to just go with material and wall thickness. Mm-hmm. Oh, I don't want a 1-inch wall thickness, I want a 0.1-inch wall thickness. For everything on LV3, we actually do mass overrides. So rather than telling it the density and the wall thickness and the dimensions, you can say, I know how much this component weighs, it weighs however many ounces. And I know where the center of mass is, it's however far from the front of the part.
Is that because the simulator assumes it's a different type of material?
So if you're just letting it calculate the mass from material density and dimensions, it's going to assume that it's uniform density. And almost nothing on LV3 is uniform density. Like, it's all got holes in the side and chunks of aluminum at the ends. And yeah.
Just all sorts of things that are done.
Yep. So it's easier just to weigh it and find the center of mass.
I think,
empirically.
Too, if it is, like, I'm assuming uniform density right now for mine, just because it's just carbon fiber, and we're assuming that's uniform. You can create materials, I believe.
Yes,
I did that too.
You can.
So you can create, if you're doing some sort of custom material, like our carbon fiber, I did create, I figured out the density of it, and I entered that in, and then now it's a material that I use.
Okay.
I don't remember how to do that, though.
I forgot.
At the bottom of component material, there's a custom.
Yeah, that's right.
Oh, really?
Yeah. You just go down all the way.
Ah, you gotta scroll down.
Custom, yeah, and you make one.
Yeah.
I just call it CF.
What, one of the options is office paper?
Okay, yeah, I guess. You can apply it.
So, this rocket right now, I'm tempted to skip ahead to simulation stuff to show what it would do without fins.
Yes.
Steel.
So, I don't think we technically need an engine block. I think we just say this component has a motor mount. And then we'll give it like a 1-inch overhang, which is probably big for a rocket this size.
Right? Motor overhang, is it sticking out then by 1-inch out of the back end of the rocket?
Yeah, so we'll see that when we add in the motor. So let's go to motors and configuration and add in a new configuration and double click on it and choose a motor. What would be a good magnitude for this?
So for L1, L2 is easy, guys, because it's just, you're going to be at H is your bare minimum. For L1, you're going to be between H and I's, and then you can move it up and stuff like that. I recommend, though, for your L1s, choose an H.
How do you set the motor again? I'm not sure where to...
Are you in the top? So you can just double click on
that line.
None? Ah.
Yeah, double click on the Y2, and your same thing now. So H is, sorry, I was just telling this. And the other thing, too, is your diameter. A lot of you guys will have a 38. Either 29 is, like, the minimum, or, like, about a 38. Which around that range or so will probably be about your size for motors. That's all I was going
to
say.
Should we pick what seems
and
to be correct in
this
terms
what
of total impulse?
Huh?
Once we decide the motor is
that
the only thing that really matters, total impulse, or are there other parameters?
There's a lot of things that matter.
That is inches.
So I mean, obviously, we want to choose one that'll fit in our rocket. Total impulse is
the
more fine-tooth measure of motor size. So the letter of the motor is what power of 2 the total impulse fits into. We want to just choose any random thing.
Well, the designation starts with, well, not all of them.
And on that motor, the rocket kit sheet I put together on the towards the bottom of it is all the impulse breakdown, like all the letters and what they represent. I even put Falcon Heavy on there in case you want to know what letter representation they can, they could use that they definitely don't, because that's makes sense.
So some of the names of the exact motors are a little weird, and you kind of have to know which part of the designation you're looking for. So the common name of this would be an H54, mm-hmm. and the common name of this would be an H87.
What are the numbers
designate? I know some of them. Do you know? I can tell you.
Yeah, what do the numbers after the letter describe?
So some of them, let's go to this one, for example. I'm not sure about the first letters there, first numbers there. H,
total
so that's
impulse.
It's the total impulse. And then the 12A, I believe ones that don't have that mean that there is not a delay grain. 12A would be represent the time of delay for that.
12 seconds?
Yes, I believe
12
so.
After.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Something like that. And then the WH or something like that, if it has some sort of lettering after it, that usually represents whatever flare or whatever it comes with, you know. Like white lightning, black thingy, you know. It black something, black smoke.
Yes, the legendary black thingy.
MS is like metal storm. That was one of mine. And so it just got, you know, like the metal shards kind of shooting out of it, like we saw, you know, watching. Those were Sparkies. So
yeah.
Something like a metal storm. MS.
Electrical engineers and motors.
What? yeah, so that's what usually those letters represent. It's really on the company and what those are actually, you know, called.
Mm. VMAX?
Yeah, Velocity Max is probably their, like, highest, you know. I don't know. They have funny little, that's just like a company name. The big ones to watch for are the ones that have some number like in an A that usually represents the time of delay before it will hit the black powder charge for separation. So obviously don't want one that's too late or too soon. Okay.
You guys will probably have a longer list of stuff because I just have only Cesaroni selected right now because we only have a Cesaroni casing for LV3 at least.
Oh yeah, and you have ejection charge delays at 9 as well. I think it's up there.
Oh yeah, why is that set up there?
You may have set it.
Yeah, probably.
If you select the one below it with 12. I think it'll change to 12. No, I'm saying the rocket below the one you have selected it in the
Oh yeah, sorry. Okay, yeah. So some of those don't actually then have that delay. The ones that say 12 actually mean 12 then. That's the way to go.
Yeah.
Or 14. I think that one's 14, yeah.
Yeah, I have a bunch of rockets that they're
probably
different company that don't pop the ejection charge, so they just say none.
Cicerone is actually harder to come by. They recommend Aerotech, FYI. Aerotech's a lot easier to get for them. Cicerone.
The vendors,
yeah. Okay. Let's talk to Bay Area quite a bit about motors and choices, and he's like, those are very rare, more rare to come by, usually more expensive. So we may still buy one if they have whatever. All right, so you picked a motor.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. Oh my god.
So this is gonna give us interesting information if we simulate it. How much do we need to configure stuff? Okay, it already has. So let's not mess with this yet. Let's just see what it does.
Weight, right?
No. So the red dot is center of pressure.
Okay.
And the little
-6 caliber, dude.
Plus symbol-y thing. The little plus symbol is the center of mass.
Can you tell me what center of pressure is? I remember you talking about that before with LV3.
So,
add the ballast.
Without getting into mathy stuff, this is going to suck for people who are watching this afterwards.
He's holding a pen.
Oh, I know, I could do a super jank thing. I could do a super duper jank thing.
Camera.
Super jank.
But the nifty, I can see you. You took your thing. It's Joe.
So we're going to have a screen recorder recording a webcam. so if we have a pen that we're holding up, my fingers are down at the bottom, and they're pushing towards the center of mass of the pen. The center of mass is probably going to be here somewhere. And right now, I only have friction holding the pen up. if I loosen my grip a bit, just so I'm only supporting the weight of the pen, it's going to fall down. The reason for that being, as soon as this pen is a little bit away from vertical, if it's just tweaked over a little bit, gravity at the center of mass is going to be pushing down this way. My finger is going to be pushing up this way, and they're going to be offset by a little bit. So there's going to be a torque exerted on the pen, and that's going to make it tweak around further. And there's going to be a larger torque, and that's going to make it torque around further, and there's going to be a larger torque. So if your center of pressure is pointing towards your center of mass, that's bad. So in a rocket, it's flipped around, where most of the, at least in a rocket without fins, all of the pressure, or most of the pressure, it's going to be at the nose cone, and it's going to be pushing back towards the center of mass. Mm-hmm. And that direction of pushing is always going to be parallel to the direction of flight. So if you're flying forwards and your center of pressure is up here and you tweak off a little bit, you're still flying that way, but now, you know, your center of pressure is a little bit offset from your center of mass, and it's going to tweak over further. And then, you know, eventually you'll start flying that way a little bit, and you'll, you know, redirect again. So it'll fly around and do this crazy thing. which,
like figure eight.
If you've ever, for example, tried to turn Piccolo Pete's into bottle rockets, you'll have experienced this.
I think I've seen it just in bottle rockets.
Yeah, probably that too. So if you have fins at the back of the rocket, and the rocket kind of perturbs over a little bit, it's going to present a little more area of the fins, and then your center of pressure is going to be back here. And so that is just going to push the rocket back to straight. So basically what fins do is automatically passively correct any deviation from your current direction.
So the reason larger rockets don't need fins is because they have gimbaling
engines. No. Oh, yes. Exactly.
Vectoring, yeah.
Thrust vector.
They do need fins unless they have thrust vectoring.
Or they
so
just don't care where they go.
Right.
I was doing a Google search on telemetrums, and I found that.
Huh.
What
wow.
Is that?
How big is that? That's
it
massive.
Looks
huge.
There's
a forklift.
There's a forklift
right
next
to
it. Huh.
But
free shipping, you guys.
Wooden model.
I mean, we could put
right,
some, a
probably
lot of
not
models.
$329.
That's actually
for
really
the
reasonable.
The
we
house.
Should. I'm sure that's a joke, but we should totally take him up on that and
Mac
put that right
City,
outside.
Metro Manila.
Where is it?
Philippines.
Oh well, it's free shipping, so whatever. It's not our problem.
We can have it by August. Free shipping if you come get it yourself.
Okay, so we have our simulation.
So you go over to the flight simulation that you haven't done already, and then you hit new simulation. Or no, sorry, you.
It should start with
the
simulation.
Okay. Yeah, sorry. It was already there. My bad. Delete you. Goodbye. Yeah, no, it's okay. Okay. There you go. Now you can hit run.
So we run it, and it does stuff, and we plot it. And let's just naively say, yeah, sure, let's see what's going on. Let's not even change anything. And we look at it, and oh the vertical acceleration is doing something that we wouldn't expect. And the vertical velocity is doing something we wouldn't expect, going negative.
Hey, though, it did go up. Look at the altitude. It did go
yeah,
up.
Yeah, it actually went up. doesn't seem quite parabolic.
110
feet? Yeah, only went 100 feet.
Oh, this is excellent. Wait. Altitude, yeah, 100 feet.
Yeah. Let's try and get everything on the actual screen here.
And then it went below zero.
Yeah.
It hits the ground a little fast, but, right? Let's see.
Yeah, how many meters did it per second did it hit? 20?
Yeah,
15.
Yeah, 15.
No, this is feet.
Not bad.
And I'm sorry.
Well, I had velocity in meters per second because bastardized units.
Looks like it did some lithographing there, though.
Yeah. In fact, does it even have an ejection charge? Do we have?
Probably not.
I mean, we don't.
Doesn't
we
look like
we
it.
Didn't put a parachute in there, so.
So it would be doing that anyways.
Yeah.
I think the motor's still firing.
I'm really disappointed.
That might be.
According to the
export
went
this Kerbal Space Program,
like
actually watch it fly.
Right.
Actually, yeah, like if the time it takes down below,
oh, yeah.
it's like 1.1 seconds after flight, it hits the ground. So I mean, those the burns aren't that long. I mean, that but they're definitely longer than 1 second. So
2.5.
His is a little different, but
that goes pretty.
Yeah,
good.
So I have the weather conditions set to
nice.
Like. Whatever the average conditions
so you can
in Brothers are,
and cancel and you can go
and like during the summer.
Fun. Where do you
do
that at?
Oh, changing weather conditions.
Yeah, I haven't done that before. Is it?
If you edit the simulation.
Oh, okay.
All
this wind
stuff.
Speed and okay.
Yeah.
Very nice.
And
you're just looking at Brothers, basically summertime.
Yeah.
Brothers.
Yeah, I think these are the coordinates of Brothers.
Okay.
Sounds right.
Yeah.
So we can kind of infer from that plot that something weird happened.
Huh. Apogee in 0.7 seconds.
there are some more useful parameters we can look at, or more useful variables we can look at. There's just a crap ton of stuff that OpenRocket will tell you. Because it's a simulation, and so it calculate whatever you want to know about, even if something that wouldn't be physically measurable. The things we care about are stability margin calibers, and I find angle of attack is also really helpful. So I'm actually going to explain stability margin caliber first. So we already know center of pressure. Hopefully we already all understand what center of mass is. So these two dots are center of pressure and center of mass. And in this little graphical preview, it's just telling them at some arbitrary value. I think the default is Mach 0.3. I changed it to Mach 0.1 because that's roughly equivalent to what LV3 comes off the rail as at. I think at low Mach numbers, for whatever reason, this estimate isn't quite right. So I wouldn't even pay that much attention to what estimate it shows in the graphical preview. The thing you actually care about is where these points are when it comes off the rail. So stability margin caliber, let's understand each word of it. We already understand stability. What's a margin? A margin is just any little bit of extra safety stuff, right? It's a thing plus a little bit more, and the plus a little bit more is the margin. So the margin is asking how far back is the center of pressure from the center of mass? And in here, you see it's negative. It's -6 calibers. So what's a caliber? A caliber is just a reference length. And I think by default, it's the diameter of the rocket. So we are 6 rocket diameters ahead of the center of mass. The center of pressure is 6 rocket diameters ahead of the center of mass. So that's what we're asking for when we plot stability margin caliber.
Do you want the center of pressure to be behind the center of mass?
Yes. You want the center of pressure to point away from the center of mass. Otherwise, it's going to be unstable.
What does point away mean in reference to the dot we see?
So for the rocket, it's always pointing to the right.
Okay.
In this view. Because it's always pointing opposite the direction of travel.
Right.
Because that's where drag goes. So we do stability margin calipers, and angle of attack is just so angle of attack is you're traveling in one direction and your rocket's pointed in a direction. What's the deviation between those two?
Hmm. After a certain point, I'm guessing that you don't want it to be pointing that much.
So because
you're trying to go to orbit.
Well, so even an orbital rocket is going to have a really low angle of attack, because as it arcs over,
yeah,
it's still pointing in the direction of travel.
True.
Okay. The direction of travel just happens to be sideways.
Yeah.
Oh, this is angle of attack with reference to the horizon.
No. Angle of attack is always with reference to the direction you're moving.
Why does it start at 90 degrees, though?
Because we have wind. Here, let me...
So it's immediately outside.
Let me get video here. So we start with our rocket pointing up, and we have wind blowing this way. And so the free stream, the direction of the fluid relative to the direction the rocket's pointing, is 90 degrees. Because the wind's going this way and the rocket's pointing this way. And as the rocket accelerates, the wind is still going this way, the rocket's moving this way, so the total relative motion of the wind is going to be something like this.
I thought angle of attack was literal angle of the rocket's frame.
Nope. Angle of attack is relative to its motion in the fluid.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah.
So
as you go faster and faster, it's going to be closer and closer to just parallel.
So at time equals zero, does the simulation assume that there's no launch rail?
At time equals zero, it assumes there's a launch rail.
There is one.
Mm-hmm.
Then shouldn't the angle of attack be zero?
No, because you still got wind blowing past the
rocket.
But
you can't... Oh, it's through the fluid.
Yeah.
And the fluid's moving.
Motion through the fluid is
yeah.
what determines angle of attack.
And they'll do during your guys' launches, they'll actually sometimes will tilt the launch rails intentionally so that it's launching... like into the wind, so that when it comes back with the chutes, it will come back, you know. For example, as if the wind's blowing towards the highway, they're going to definitely lean it more into the wind such that it won't hopefully go to the highway when it does come back on a chute. So the angle attack would be different on that one, right? Because your launch rail itself is actually then angled as well.
Yeah, so if you're launching into the wind, that's going to reduce your angle of attack.
Yes.
So it's not in reference to the ground, it's in reference to the fluid.
Yep. Exactly. And fun fact about wind and fins, if there's a lot of wind as you come off the launch rail and you have some large angle attack because of the wind, you're actually going to angle into the wind because you're stable and your rocket wants to stabilize to zero angle of attack.
Look at this, which definitely does some things.
So there's a lot of crazy stuff happening here.
So it comes off the rail at first, it looks like, because it's...
yeah, let's add a thing here. Let's add in launch rod clearance.
So I'll show us when it happens.
Yeah, so if you're plotting stability margin caliber, mm-hmm. here it's our green line. If we click and drag a box, we can zoom in on stuff. It only plots stability margin caliber after you're off the rail.
Mm,
okay. So you don't always have to check this on, because if you're plotting stability margin caliber, you're going to just see where it is. But it's nice having this vertically align everything. So we can see we start with a negative caliber off the rail, which isn't great. And you can see our angle of attack decreases a bit, but then rapidly increases. So we aren't stabilizing ourselves. We're actually increasing our angle of attack.
Does 180 mean it's pointed upside down?
Wait. Is it actually 180 relative
to
the fluid?
Yeah,
so 180 means...
Movement, it's not.
Gosh dang
not
it.
Pointing.
What's 180? Isn't it directly in the wind? No.
So 180, so if you had zero angle of attack,
mm-hmm.
say this is your nose cone, this is your motor,
mm-hmm.
Zero angle of attack is doing this. 180 angle of attack is doing this.
Oh, wait, I thought it was motion relative to the fluid.
Relative to the fluid. So if you have 180 angle of attack, that means you've done this and then flipped around.
But I thought it was motion, not orientation relative to the fluid.
It's motion and orientation. So
motion of the fluid and then your orientation to that.
So in the reference frame of your rocket, it's where is the fluid going?
Oh.
So in the reference frame of your rocket, if the fluid's flowing from nose cone to fin can, that's zero angle of attack.
Oh, angle of attack is the rocket is the reference frame, so the environment is moving around it.
Yep.
Okay. That makes sense.
Okay, so do we do one flip? How many flips do we do then?
Every time it inverts, it's a flip.
So if we drag a box like this, we can zoom in, going from upper left to lower right. If we drag a box from lower right to upper left, it gets us back to the full zoom. How many flips do we do?
Two, three, four. And
it's like half a flip, right?
I'm guessing there's no way we can actually visualizes.
So that's why I'm talking about like all these parameters is which parameters do you need to kind of build the story of what's going on? Because it won't give you a little animation. You could write a script to take the outputs from OpenRocket and make a little animation.
You could buy RockSim for like $100. RockSim does that, but it's this is free.
Yeah, if you want to learn a little bit of Python, it wouldn't be that hard to write an animation that interprets the outputs, because you can export this data to a CSV, and do lots of fancy secondary analysis on it.
That's what I've been doing.
Well, then you could also do arbitrary things like put like little chibi PSAS characters writing on the rocket.
Right, exactly. So if you wanted to do that in the plot and export menu, you'd just go to export data, and you'd check the different stuff you want to export. And there's no reason not to just check everything, right? And export it, and then choose your file name. And then if I go look at that, do I want to open it in LibreOffice? I don't think I do, but whatever. I won't actually open it in LibreOffice. I'll just show you what it interprets. So then you'd get, you know, tables of, here's all the time steps of the simulation so that you know when all of these numbers are occurring. And here's the altitude, so you can get altitudes as a function of time. Here's the velocity, and here's all the other crazy stuff you can get.
That's weird, it must have exported.
Oh, yeah, so if you're putting it into a spreadsheet, you have to be careful to tell the spreadsheet what is the separator. Mm-hmm.
CSVs aren't always actually CSV.
Yeah.
Or CS.
I think it's a common misconception that it's comma separated. I think it's technically command separated value. But, yeah.
I think it's
separate. What are some other things that would... that would inform us?
Mass.
Would be kind of informative. I think what I want is like angle from vertical. Not Coriolis acceleration.
What's so this is a simulation. What's a
vertical
visual,
orientation
is
zenith.
That's what it is.
Yeah, so I mean, you could, for example, write a script that takes a little arrow and puts it at the XYZ coordinate of the rocket and then orients it according to the orientation of the rocket and then give you, like, a visualization of it. But for just prototyping stuff in OpenRocket, it's kind of faster just to know which variables to look at to kind of rebuild the story in your mind, because you don't necessarily need to see exactly what it's doing. You just need to diagnose what it's doing.
Right.
This is upside down now.
Right. So yeah. if I look at the vertical orientation from the zenith, let's just make this a favorite application for now. If I look at vertical orientation from the zenith, so angle of attack was the relative motion of the fluid in the reference frame of the rocket. Mm-hmm. Zenith is what you were probably thinking of to start with, the orientation of the rocket relative to the ground.
Right.
So I think this would be 90 degrees zenith or zero zenith.
Looks like it's plotting.
One of those two.
Okay, we'll see, I guess.
Yeah, we'll see when we plot it.
That'd probably be the most intuitive.
So zenith is green. So yeah, vertical is 90 degrees.
Okay.
Because
so
when we start,
like a plane,
we're at
then basically
90 degrees.
And it's 90 degrees off that plane.
Yep.
Okay.
And so yeah, we go to minus 90. So we're angling over to the side, and now we're going down. And then we angle over to the side and go down again.
So now we're like level with the
and
ground.
Then we go vertical and then down and then vertical and then down a little bit and vertical again.
Oh, so there's a minor burnout actually. Yeah, sorry, that is a 1.25 then. Some of you guys might not even have. There's a motor burnout right here.
So
oh,
I think this is the sort of launch where they might say, please don't come back. Because that's where people would go running and screaming. So let's see if we can fix that.
You took us to the Northwest Extreme Rocket Show, actually.
That's where this one would have belonged.
Yeah, so
experimental.
This would be one of the little. This would be one of the exciting rockets that we strap to the side as our third stage that fly off and spin around, and everyone goes ooh ah, right. So there's a lot of different kinds of fins we can add. These are all fins, just different models of fins. So freeform is, actually no, I think LV3 uses trapezoidal. Freeform is if you want to do something real crazy, and it literally just lets you draw a fin. How do we add a point? I don't remember how. Oh, that's how we add a point.
Oh, yeah.
You just click on the line. So it allows you to do whatever insano bazonkers fin shape you
Batman
want.
Batman symbol.
Yeah.
Yes.
Double fins.
Or like battle axe fins.
And if I recall, split fins makes them like all, yeah, it makes them all separate features. So if you wanted to have fins that didn't have like rotational symmetry to them, that's what you'd do. But that's dumb, let's not do that.
Step one fin.
Yeah.
Actually, what would that do?
It would not add stability to the rocket, because as the rocket deviated from zero angle of attack,
mm-hmm.
and it presented some area of the fin, rather than putting a torque on the whole rocket, it would just roll the rocket so that the fin was parallel with the flow.
For decrease stability.
I think it would do nothing. Yeah, it would be marginally better than nothing.
Yeah, better than nothing, but yeah.
Because, like, because if this little sucks. If this little pocket clip is the one fin that we have,
mm-hmm.
and we deviate a little bit from zero angle of attack, this really isn't visible in the video. Oh well. If we deviate a little bit from the angle of attack, sure, there's going to be a little torque pushing it back this way, but there's also going to be torque trying to roll the rocket so that the fin just goes back. And the moment of inertia this way is teeny, teeny, tiny compared to the moment of inertia this way. So it's just going to roll back.
Gotcha.
Is there a way to do like corkscrew fins so it makes things spin?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I saw an OSU group do that. I don't think it went
until we just set them to kind of spiral.
I want to say that's can't. So
right.
Let's just try setting can't to like something insane, 20 degrees.
This is max.
So if you want to do a pizza box, basically.
Yeah. So this would spin the rocket around violently.
If not, tear them off.
Yeah. So let's set can't back to 0 degrees. Well, there is a legitimate reason that you might want to have some can't on your fins if you wanted to spin stabilize your rocket. That's not really going to help you unless you have a rail that allows that.
Oh, true.
Right? So if you had a launch rod and a little circle that went around the launch rod, you might be able to actually get the rocket to spin off the thing. It'd be a little janky. So basically what spin stabilization is you turn your rocket into a gyroscope. Because a spinning object wants to keep its spin in the same direction. So if the whole damn rocket is spinning,
Or like a flare where the fins are collapsed somehow, and it's in a tube, and they don't expand until they're out of the tube.
Oh, yeah.
That'd be interesting.
Number
of fins, though, if you want to have, you can increase those.
Yeah. So 4 fins, for example, might be a lot easier to manufacture because you're only working with 90 degree angles.
You set the can at 15 and added trapezoidal fins.
Oh, nice. Oh, so that actually.
I mean, assuming it doesn't destroy.
Wait, what's going on?
And then it goes up.
Oh, wow, so it's negative the whole time.
How is it
but
that
your angle of attack stays.
My altitude stays up here.
Yeah, so you've actually made a spin stabilized rocket.
No matter how fast it's
wait,
spinning.
Wait, can I see? What are CG and CP? Are they in the same spot?
What?
If you go
no,
back
he's
to
actually got negative calibers.
Oh, seriously?
Yeah. So that's legitimately a spin stabilized rocket.
Oh, and this is, what is this, Zenith? Vertical, yeah, vertical orientation.
Yeah, so it's staying
so
near
like
90. So
stability
that's
margin
to
calibers
do.
Are...
So it's
really
just kind
green.
Of spinning around at a 1 degree or, you know,
wow.
A couple degrees of
you need to send me this file. We need to make this. We should try this one out.
I just like how the graph, like, kind of frames the...
It's just like the simulation.
The altitude.
Yeah. What if
there's
like a roll
yeah, so
velocity
this is,
or something?
This is one of the reasons that I use bastardized units. Is I like everything to fit in just 2 axes, right? I don't like to have one plot that's gigantic and one plot that's teeny tiny.
Right.
Because it's nice to be able to see them all at the same time.
Okay. That's a fun one.
Because when you're just diagnosing, like, what is the rocket doing, you care less about the absolute value of those variables and more about what's the shape of the plot. Is it positive or negative?
Right. Hey, what is why does it end here with a positive altitude still?
It's probably just set in the simulation to end at apogee.
End it. Oh, okay.
Oh. Yeah, I don't really got to just take it like this is beautiful, we shall take it from here.
There's just a little platform up there that just
yes,
whoop,
yeah,
sits on
there.
So what stuff do I need to explain here? So fin rotation, actually let's drag this over so we can just see the fins. So fin rotation I think is just the phase that they are around the side of the rocket. Yeah, it really doesn't make a difference at all. Root chord. So this is aerospace-y terminology. I should check who's texting me, because it might be important.
Roll rate. There we go.
Not very important. Just someone texting me the word Bepis.
Nice.
How do I want to draw things? I'll draw things like this.
I think my roll rate is in excess of 125 million.
So if I have, let's shrink that a bit. If I have my rocket, that's a rocket. See, there's a nose cone, it's a rocket. So if I have a fin, strictly speaking, in super duper correct aerospacey terminology, oh shoot, how do I make a dotted line with a trackpad? That's how. Tediously. So, strictly speaking, in Totes Pro aerospace terminology, if you extended your fins down to the center line of the rocket, Totes Pro aerospace people would say that this distance here is the root chord. OpenRocket says that this is called the root chord. You can talk about chords at any position along a fin or a wing. Chord just refers to a distance that's parallel to the attitude of the vehicle. So you could have a mean chord, the average width of a fin or a wing. So this would be like the mean chord of your fin. And can anyone guess what this would be called?
The
tip chord?
Exactly. So now you know what chord is.
Tip chord.
So here we have the root chord of the fins. And if we scale that, we're changing how big they are where they meet the rocket. And if we change the tip chord, we're changing how big they are at the end of the fin. And if we change the height, we're changing how far away the tip is from the skin of the rocket. Now, sweep is another aerospacey term. I'll just use the same colors. So if I had a fin, God damn, that's terrible. Pretend that's a rectangle. If I had a fin that were just rectangular out like that, that would be zero sweep. And depending on who you ask, that might be 90 degree sweep, depending on where you measure the angle from. If I recall, the way OpenRocket measures it is like this. Yeah, it's what's the angle of the leading edge? So if we, this is another obnoxious thing. Most like technical literature will talk about the sweep angle. And you may notice I just intuitively started talking about sweep angle. sweep length is, let's change colors again. Sweep length is this distance here. How far is the front of the tip from a zero sweep position? So that little red line is the sweep length.
Is that is there a difference between OpenRocket and how other people would define that, like based on the root chord difference?
So in OpenRocket, you can, it does give you sweep angle. So if I change sweep length, it automatically changes the sweep angle,
mm-hmm.
and vice versa. So if I change it to 0 degrees, it's just flat on the front. I feel like I maybe didn't answer your question.
If you set a sweep length in OpenRocket, is the same sweep length that someone like NASA or SpaceX or you would use?
Maybe. So in DATCOM, for example, it only talks about sweep angle. So like really old NASA papers, you'll probably only find them talking about sweep angle. And really, it just comes down to what convention is most convenient to the person.
I think a C-sweep angle making more sense to talk about. I mean,
sweep angle makes
sense. Like doing the geometry go, oh, okay, that's what angle it's at. Right?
Yeah.
Every time, do you want to look one up?
Sweep angle makes a bit more sense when you're dealing with vehicles that'll go supersonic. Because whatever. So you guys know about Mach cones, right? The idea of a Mach cone makes sense. So your Mach cone is going to be at some angle depending on what your Mach number is. And you want the angle of anything on the vehicle to be sharper than the angle of your Mach cone. Because otherwise you're going to have shock waves generated by one part of the vehicle colliding with other parts of the vehicle. And that's not good. So if you say, for example, know that you're going to travel at Mach 2, or know that you're always going to travel at less than Mach 2, then you'd want to make sure that your sweep angle is more extreme than whatever the angle of a Mach cone at Mach 2 is.
From that part? Or is the Mach cone based on just the speed and air pressure?
Mach cone, the angle of the Mach cone is based on your airspeed and the speed of sound wherever you are.
So it's nothing to do with how, you know, oblique your surface is.
Right.
Alpha.
So if we had, say, a Mach cone coming off of the nose cone here, let's say that's our Mach cone.
Yeah.
And we pick some point on that cone, this length is going to be proportional to the speed of sound. And this length is going to be proportional to our speed. So if it's 45 degrees, we're at Mach 1.
I see. Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or, oh yeah, did I fuck up the speed of sound? Yeah.
No. But you could actually do it, so it's just a sine of that Mach angle, so that angle whatever. So you're trying to solve.
Oh yeah, arc sine of 1 over Mach number.
Yeah.
I did actually fuck up that explanation, though. It's this length, right angle to the Mach cone. Because, you know, the whole thing propagates at, that's a terrible arrow, the whole thing propagates out. It's a wavefront propagating at the speed of sound. So this is the length that's proportional to speed of sound.
That makes sense.
And this is the length that's proportional to your speed, your airspeed, not your ground speed. But, I mean, I think for most intents and purposes, they're going to be basically the same. You're not going to be flying in winds that are close to the order of magnitude of the
ground speed. Is zero, but your airspeed could be Mach 2.
It could, if the wind were traveling at Mach 2. Which it probably, yeah, if it is, you've got other problems. So
you want to get into underground shelter at that point.
We probably want these fins to be even bigger. So let's increase the root chord. There are other problems to worry about other than just stability.
So if I did.
And let's throw, so this is an interesting point about fin design. Let's take our sweep length back to zero. So we've got big old fins, and we still need to move our center of pressure further back.
Why is it square?
Because the thing I'm about to try and demonstrate.
Oh, okay.
So we've got big old fins, and we want to keep moving our center of pressure further back. We could continue to make the fins even bigger. And that would help us a bit. Another thing we could do is we could mess with the sweep so that most of the fin is further back. We've still got the same amount of fin, but the fins are further back. We could even, you know, scale them around like this so they hang out the, like, remember the, what was it? The flat Earth guy? remember the picture of his rocket, how the fins are like way the hell back behind his motor. Mm-hmm. And he just has this huge skirt extending the rocket to get the fins further back. That's because he had, you know, probably a cast iron tank as a pressure vessel, and that was his motor. So he had a lot of mass to try and get further forward.
Probably needed to be a cast iron tank for the steam powered.
Yeah, exactly. So we've got friggin' huge ass fins, and we're neutrally, well, at least for this little preview speed, we're like neutrally stable. This is probably like the wrong point in the design to start worrying about fins, because you'll notice we don't have any internals. I feel like there's some system that's supposed to go up here.
The explosive?
I wonder what it could be.
Yeah, the warhead, there we go.
Yeah, exactly. So
that would
just
be a mass component, right?
Yeah.
I mean, fast enough travel.
So actually, fun fact, there's a lot of components here, like a centering ring to center the motor, or a bulkhead to mount stuff to, or an engine block, which I think is just for mounting the engine so you transfer struts, and a coupler for attaching rings together. All they are is just mass components with special names.
Yeah, you could really just add the mass component instead.
Yep. And in fact, that's what I was doing for a long time in LV3. And then I realized, oh, there's specially named things for this. That's nice. So
you could put some centering rings on that motor if you wanted, for example.
Yeah.
Chutes, all that other stuff.
So if we wanted to incorporate into our design that there's a thing to center the motor, we could, say, put a centering ring and say
one at the bottom,
it's indexed from the top of the component. And we'll move it to, like, there.
Yeah, you should do two, but yeah, that's good.
Oh, yeah, because
yeah.
I've got LV3 stuff stuck in my head, I'm imagining that there's, like, a thrust flange here or something.
Oh, yeah, I know. That center ring becomes your thrust, not really.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
So, yeah, I guess for the sake of completeness, let's add another one. And let's edit this one so they're not sitting on top of each other.
Where are the centering rings? Right here. So. Yeah, Joe's just cool because he's got his in like a black format.
Yeah.
I need to change mine. That's good.
So we've got a parachute. How do we change the size of it in the rocket?
I mean, that's the
diameter of the parachute itself.
Packed length?
Yeah, that's it. That's totally it.
Packed diameter, yeah.
So let's make it like... That sounds right. And I don't know how big parachutes are supposed to be for rockets this size. And let's set it a little bit back.
How big is our rocket?
LV3?
No, this one.
This one, I think, is 3 inches in diameter or something. Yeah, 3 inches in diameter and a little under 3 feet long.
I think that chute, FYI, I think that was, did I say 12-inch diameter?
Yeah.
Tiny chute.
I have no sense of scale for something this size. What sounds right?
2 feet?
5 feet?
Oh.
4 feet?
Okay.
Something like that? Feet, not inches. Yeah, just 3 or something like that.
Okay.
Yeah, or 4. Depends how heavy your thing is.
Right. So.
I recommend that.
I guess it's just automatically guessing. Oh, because it's nylon. Okay.
Yeah.
And coefficient drag 0.8 sounds about right. I mean, drag coefficient is only ever going to be 0 and between 0 and 1. Or, no, that's not right. It can be above 1. But it's going to be close to 1.
Is that if your thrust is pointing the opposite direction? Your drag coefficient is...
The drag coefficient for the rocket itself is hopefully a lot smaller than 0.8. 0.8 is the drag coefficient for the parachute.
Ah.
And literally, it is a fudge parameter for the shape of the parachute.
Because usually you're thinking of like a solid body and then the coefficient around that. But
the chute since it's flexible.
So this is mechanical engineering-y fluid stuff that we won't get into, but basically the energy density of the fluid in the reference frame of the vehicle, you multiply that by the drag coefficient, and that gives you a force. So the drag coefficient has... No, it doesn't have units. Right? Yeah, it doesn't have units. So, actually, I take that back. Energy density multiplied by the cross-sectional area of the thing, whatever you're talking about, multiplied by drag coefficient gives you the drag force.
Or in the back of our fluids textbook, it's just like, you know, all these different shapes, basically. Like
yeah.
A person on a bike, what kind of drag coefficient do they have? They have a number for us, so if we want to do that, we just look it up sometimes and use that. So.
And so, fun fact, you can just look up the drag coefficient of a cylinder at various flow regimes.
Okay.
And for antennas, they quote a cross-sectional area of the antenna. And you can actually calculate the drag on that antenna at different speeds.
Mm-hmm.
And it corresponds very closely with their quoted drag forces.
You look this up. You actually look this up to figure that out.
Yep. Because this was when we were trying to spec how much mass we need to weigh that thing down so it doesn't fly off the building and kill someone.
Yeah, that's probably a good idea.
So for anyone watching this later, there's a giant antenna in the room with us that we're talking about.
12 feet by 12 feet or something?
Yeah, something like that. So you'll notice that now that we've added the parachute, our center of mass is further forward. That's because the parachute has some mass. And we've got a little bit better stability margin caliber. Oh, yeah, that might be helpful.
Yeah, well, you could just tie it to the nose cone, let the nose cone come down.
Let's see, I have to add it to this component. So OpenRocket kind of cares about what the parent of a component is. So stuff like a parachute or a shock cord needs a piece of the airframe to be its parent. Whereas stuff like a body tube just goes in line in the rocket. It doesn't need... The parent is the rocket. So on this body tube, let's add a shock cord. What's a reasonable value?
5-6 feet. Yeah.
5 feet?
Sure.
Okay.
Seems like something. And you do too, because it's probably to be tethered to the nose cone and the back section, or just, you know.
Right, so
you have to decide where the rocket's splitting when it does the charge.
Yeah.
So, and then put
which I don't think OpenRocket really cares about.
It
just considers that everything is tied together after deployment.
Would you make the parachute's parent the shock cord?
Wait, doesn't it?
It doesn't care.
It assumes it is, right?
It's up to you where it's going to split.
Right.
It's a good thing, though, is so let's say for like my rocket, I have it tied from the nose cone to the chute to the back end.
Mm-hmm.
But when it's in the rocket, most of it will be just kind of laying back towards the end of it. So you can kind of do is, because that little symbol is going to be all the shock cord weight right there.
Mm-hmm.
So you could spread it out across the entire length, but since I know it's going to be sitting towards the bottom, I can move it towards the bottom and say that's actually where it will really sit at.
Yeah.
So.
Well, can you? Sorry, that's the body tube. That's why it looks weird. So you could...
It's positioned, yes. So that basically put it like where the mean's at.
Do
know.
Something like that.
Sure, yeah. And then you could put it where you think for the most part, where it's going to sit.
Yeah.
Unless you have it such that it tucks or rolls or something around a certain spot.
Because I think for the purpose of simulation, that's just another mass.
Yeah, it's just adding more mass. But it's useful because then it changes your CG, obviously. So
mm-hmm.
Not a whole lot, though, if you guys have noticed. It's
yeah.
Way much. No.
Yeah.
Unless you
Be some like steel cables or something like that.
Yeah, it really doesn't move the center of gravity that much. Yeah. But it is nice to get your simulation as accurate as possible. So let's just run it again. And yeah, these are good diagnosing parameters. So you'll notice it looks a lot different now. it's actually going a few thousand feet rather than a few hundred feet. And if we zoom into the part we care about, let's see, it looks like we aren't doing any inversions. So that's good. And where's stability margin? On the right-hand side. So I like to look at just stability between rail clearance and burnout and see what shape it makes. And it looks like it kind of, you get different dynamics going on for a smaller rocket like this, because this is a lot smoother than LV3 or LV2. But we're starting with, you know, not quite one caliber, like a little less than 0.75 calibers. So they'd probably want you to have a larger caliber, right? So let's say that this is our rocket. We've got all our functional parts. One thing, well, if we increase this length, it's going to move the center pressure contributed by the nose cone.
Yeah, so that won't help, actually. Too much.
But that will move your center of mass a lot, too.
That's true.
So it does move both.
That's the recommendation I was getting from someone, just to make it long enough to...
Yeah. But let's say, for example, let's do something a little ham-fisted here. Let's say that this is some sintered pixie dust tube, some like two-layer carbon fiber tube that...
made out of cardboard.
Yeah, made out of cardboard, that we don't care about its mass. Or, you know, its mass is so small that when we scale the length, it isn't going to change anything. Then doing this... Oh, well.
I know, it's
never mind.
Changing the mass.
I'm used to having a rocket where this has like a metal tube around it, and this is half of the mass of the rocket. But take my word for it. There are scenarios when just lengthening a tube actually makes your stability margin caliber worse. So let's change that back to a foot.
And you want to change your mass over, right, probably.
Oh, yeah, that's why it's so far back.
Yeah, you have a mass over.
I was wondering why we got it further back when seemingly nothing had changed. So let's say we've taken other measures to mess with our stability margin, and we can't make a reasonable change to the structure of the rocket. One thing we could do is just add dead mass. Let's do grams just to make everything complicated. Yeah, like a sandbag or some lead shot.
Or washers. People do that too. Just
yeah, washers would probably be easier. And let's... Where do we want to put it? Put it like there, in the tip of the nose cone. So, by just adding dead mass, we can freely manipulate the center of mass. Keep in mind, though, this is less of a thing for smaller rockets, I'm guessing, but at some point you will add so much mass that you've significantly reduced the acceleration of your rocket, and you're going to be coming off the rail slower. So there's a point where it actually doesn't help you anymore.
I just imagined the rocket like just barely lifting off and then falling
right.
It's a reasonable rocket. Just have it come up.
Oh yeah, what if you actually increase the mass such that the thrust it produces isn't even enough to get it off the...
Then you just sit on the rail.
Yeah, it's a static test fire. Just test fire your motor, I guess.
And now that we've mentioned like the rail and how long the rail is, we might want to set this to something more reasonable for this size of rocket. Actually, that's probably about right. That's probably a reasonable rail length.
3 feet?
Maybe.
Is that edit simulation or somewhere
like
Oh, the ones they have are like maybe six or ten.
Yeah.
Let's call it eight.
Yeah, eight's right.
So that's actually going to help our stability a lot, because that means we're going to be coming off the rail faster, because we're going to have a longer distance to accelerate through.
Okay, there's some things.
So if we go back to our plot and we kind of try and diagnose stuff, we're still stable through the flight, so that's really good. We're still pointing up until apogee, which is very good. And if we actually look at our stability up to burnout, we start with just a little below one. So we might add a little more mass. So if we go back here and...
So that's kind of interesting, because on the graph it does show that it's below one, but when you're looking at the model here, it does say that it is above one.
Yeah, so...
You know why exactly?
This little preview, you'll notice the little tiny at m equals 0.1.
Yeah.
So at Mach number equals 0.1.
I see. So at once you're trying.
So this is a guess. And, I just realized why this doesn't really correspond that much with LV3. It's because it's probably not considering like the mass lost from the exhaust. So this is very tongue-in-cheek. This is not what you should use to determine if your rocket's stable or not. The thing that tells you whether or not it's stable is your plots. And the thing you really care about in the plots is what's your stability when you come off the rail? What's your very starting stability? And for this one, it's just above one. So this would kind of meet the rule of thumb of, is the rocket stable?
It goes up. Yep. Yeah, you can see actually when apogee happens. It's kind of fun. Basically, the deflection there.
I'm going to go pee.
Okay.
And you guys should play around with open rocket stuff.
Wait. Yeah.
Here.
Wait, you're already functioning. Oh, yes. Do you have stickers? You get enough stickers on there.
Yeah. I added a 20 kilogram mass to my nose cone.
Nice.
And its altitude is zero. Gosh, I'm gonna change it to, how about 200 grams? The thing is, it's strange. When I run my simulation, let's see, what's this exclamation point? You have a simulation menu? Okay.
Usually mean there's something that goes wrong. It's going wrong. It's telling you like that there's probably some problem, and it usually actually gives you a warning, tells you what that is.
Altitude. So it's going slowly up. Good. My roll rate does a weird thing where it's down at the bottom and then it immediately spikes to 4 million RPM.
Yeah, I wouldn't worry about that, because if you hit apogee, you'd have your deployment, and then your rocket's going to then spin like crazy it shoots out.
Look at this. So it should be spinning like crazy going up.
Yeah. Oh, actually, since you have no shoot deploy.
I have no shoot, exactly. You're
yeah,
right,
so you helicopter down is what you're doing.
No, but it's, okay, here, there's another thing. Roll rate. No, not roll rate. Should I get rid of my simulation? I think maybe it's this one. Plot. Oh no!
We can title all those simulations that way. If, you know, you come back and you want to figure out which one it was.
That's a good idea. Is that vertical velocity? I can't remember. it was the vertical orientation that was. Oh yeah, this.
I totally should have stopped the recording before it left.
Don't worry, I just think bad about you.
Oh,
too bad.
Well, I can always go verify that.
Yeah, you always verify that.
Well, you can just edit out.
No, you can hear him talk about his what? How much? 2,000? How much for the mass did you put up there?
20 kilograms in the nose cone.
Oh.
Yeah, altitude stayed at zero.
I'm actually gonna. Break it and then restart it. So, we're going to look at LV3 now. If you go to, I guess I'll do the URL from scratch. If you go to GitHub and look at the PSAS organization and look at the LV3 airframe repo, we have an OpenRocket model. At this point, we should probably start keeping the model in the repo that's specifically for whatever launch we're talking about. So at this point, it probably should be kept in like launch 13. We've kind of neglected the launch 13 repo recently. I don't know why it's taking so long to load.
I don't think there's anything in launch 13.
Yeah, there's almost nothing in there. There's the mission patch and not much else. But if you look at, like, Launch 12. Launch 12 has, like, all the avionics data and the simulations that were done to verify it before the launch. And so you'll see this is the thing that I've looked at before. What I did for, like, initially learning how to tell if a rocket was stable was I would look at the stability margin caliber and angle of attack plots for LV2 and try to make the LV3 plots have the same shape and about the same values. 'Cause I was, you know, working in a design space where I had no intuition for what was going on, and it was a whole lot of empirical stuff. So let's go back to the airframe. So right now the current OpenRocket model is under sim for simulation, and then ORK. The extension for OpenRocket files is .ORK. So you'll notice when I saved this one, it was, you know, saying, hey, I'm going to save this with a .ORK extension. And I want to say the file itself is like XML. This is less relevant information, but I want this to be in somebody's brain. Bluetooth device. Is it alphabetical? Leaf pad. Oh, never mind. I think it is like some form of XML, and I don't know why it's not showing up right. Okay, yeah, maybe it's just binary. Never mind. But anyways, there is like a library written in Python for scripting OpenRocket. So that you could, like, do arbitrary stuff with making 1,000 models and seeing which one performed best.
Iterations, huh? Iteration testing, I think.
Yeah. I tried to get that to work and kind of didn't meet with great success, but it's a thing people have done and it exists. So I want other people to know it exists, because it would be really fucking cool if we could use that. But it might be more work than it's worth. On that line of discussion, I'm going to mention the optimization stuff that OpenRocket has built in. Where this will let you choose a bunch of different parameters and a bunch of input parameters and a bunch of output parameters, and say, I want you to maximize this output parameter, and you can tweak this input parameter within certain bounds. So let's say I want to maximize my altitude. And what do I want to do with that?
Nose cone?
Yeah, let's mess with nose cone length. I forget how to actually do that.
Add?
Except add is grayed out.
Oh. This is available parameters. Maybe it's not available.
The optimization parameters allowed in the nose cone. So if we open that in the tree and we mess with the length of it.
Mm-hmm. Multiple optimization parameters?
You can. Let's not mess with the diameter of the nose cone, because that doesn't quite make sense, but we were playing with the length of that body tube earlier. So let's add the length of the body tube as a thing that we can mess with. And you know, it guesses some reasonable bounds, but let's say we couldn't manufacture a nose cone longer than 18 inches. And let's say we can only purchase body tubes that are up to 4 inches, but we can cut them to any length we want. So let's make that like 1 inch. I want to make sure it actually goes in this 1 inch. Minimum stability, 1 caliber. Maximum stability, we don't really care. And start optimization. And it'll just mess with those things until it finds a value that optimizes stuff. And we get this, you know, comically long nodes cone. But this... I forget what our altitude was before. Actually change the length of things. So let's close this and check what our altitude is.
Apogee
our apogee. The altitude of our apogee. So we have an apogee of 2,500 feet. And if we do our optimization stuff, length and body tube length. And let's just leave those how they are. Maximize apogee altitude. Yep. So we do our optimization. And, you know, it messes with things. And it looks like it's basically maxing out the length of the nose cone, which kind of makes sense because our ballast is relative to the tip of the nose cone. So kind of what it's really doing is just saying, let's move the ballast further forward, right? Mm. That does also reduce the drag on the nose cone, making it longer like that. But of course, this would be harder to manufacture. So let's apply those changes.
Wait, can you move that, have it modify that mass location as a parameter?
Yeah, totally.
That way it's not just moving the...
So
that one right there, yeah?
So let's change the position of it. And let's
maybe
say...
Maybe the length isn't that useful then, is it?
Let's say we have to have it at least 2 inches from the tip of the nose cone. And let's say it can be real far back if we really want it. But it's probably going to put it further forward. And, you know, go big or go home. Let's let it modify the mass as well. And let's say it can go up to 2 pounds. Which is kind of crazy, but sure, why not? And let's do that optimization. So we started with 2,500 feet, and now we're at 2,800 feet. And we don't, because we were messing with the ballast, we don't have, you know, quite as comically long as a nose cone anymore. And we could even save some length on our rocket. Yeah, you can throw a lot of stuff into the optimization. For example, if you didn't want to have to manufacture real big fins, you could throw in the height. One thing to consider here is it doesn't have a sense of sanity to it. So if, for example, you allowed it to mess with the position of the fins, it would probably just shoot them all the way to the back. Because why not? That reduces drag, it reduces mass, it gets your center of pressure further back. Ghost Never fins. Mind how you're actually going to manufacture it. Yeah.
So if you optimize ground hit speed, would that be setting it to be a kinetic missile?
Oh, can you do that?
If you want
to. Yeah. Yeah, you could do that. let's see what that does.
It probably would.
Oh, it's probably your shoot.
Oh,
still.
it's not going to do anything.
Probably because the
shoot. These parameters don't affect ground hit speed. Only the shoot does.
Throw your shoot in there as a parameter modify.
Oh,
and you're trying to minimize value. Try to maximize that value. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, we have it maximized.
Oh, you do? Okay, sorry. Ground hit speed have maximized. It then, yeah, modify the shoot right there below. This one.
Yeah.
Down. So, yeah. Diameter probably.
Or how about deployment altitude?
Just make it negative, right? Interesting. Okay.
Did it change it?
A
little bit.
Oh, you have a minimum on it though, so you can't see that. So 0 feet. Okay, I'm sure that's gonna set that to zero now. Oh, maybe not. Definitely more
interesting.
Long, not M shaped, you know. Oh, okay.
So the question is, which zero is this? Is it the first or second zero? Like, is it, you know, when it's about to fire, or is it when it's already hit the ground?
Yeah. But it had a foot. I don't know.
You
could also do diameter.
I think what's messing this up is the deployment altitude of the parachute doesn't actually affect its deployment altitude. It's the burnout time of the motor.
Oh, sure.
Mm-hmm. Oh, does it?
What you do is maybe remove that one and try doing the diameter of the chute and see if it can get it down to, like, nothing.
Uh-oh.
A
bug. Good. We're testing it for them.
Okay.
The chute diameter would be the one I would...
Yeah.
I think that would be good.
Let's see if it just sets it to zero.
We'll see if you can tell it to...
Okay, what's
it does have the ability to set it
to zero. Okay. Oh, there we go. 107.
Zero.
So it looks like you get it to come down at 107 meters per second.
Yeah.
15 inches.
Okay.
What other stuff did it set to weird values? It basically maximizes the mass. That makes sense. That's interesting that it gave it real big fins.
What are those missiles called that use a really, really dense mass instead of a like depleted uranium in the tip instead of a warhead? And they just fire at obscene speeds.
I think just kinetic weapons.
Probably.
Right?
Set the mass to like 500 as maximum. Because it'll have to optimize it to actually be able to get off the ground. That's actually
right.
An interesting problem. It's got to be able to get up and to have enough speed.
No.
What?
What? What'd you do?
That doesn't make sense.
Oh, it allowed the ballast to get really heavy.
So simulate.
Let's see what
that
does.
Actually will go up.
Yeah. Like, normally I would say we're getting off track, but I feel like it's actually... Oh,
sense.
Yeah, it just stays on the launch pad.
Yeah, 90 degrees the entire time.
Why? But that's optimizing for speed of ground hit, so maybe zero is like an exception
that's
or something.
Weird
I can't figure out
that,
how to deal with that.
Huh.
There's got to be a way to...
So there may be something in the optimization that's like actually getting a weird edge case of the simulator.
Yeah.
And that's what's making the value large. But yeah, let's
found
let's,
a bug.
Let's kill this. where's my thing where I started OpenRocket? Not there. I'll just do it from here.
Oh, interesting, using the terminal.
Yeah, the little launcher broke. I was saying about the LV3 stuff. So if you go into the LV3 airframe repo, and then the sim folder for simulation, and then ORK for OpenRocket files, LV3_L13 is the one that's relevant for the Launch 13. This I should actually probably remove, because it was just what if we do something dumb?
If you simulate it for the new motor you guys are using?
Yes.
Using a lot higher? Okay.
So this one that I'm about to open.
The open racing?
This actually has the O motor in
it. Okay, actually, I found this one. My bad. Yeah.
Okay.
I have
cool. So this has like all the fancy stuff in it for a drogue chute and a main chute, and pretty much everything in here is just a body tube or a mass component. Because we're really just doing bookkeeping on all the mass of the rocket. I should probably remove
insane.
Some of these cases. So Insane O is the name that the 2014 capstone chose, and I've just never changed it. One interesting point here is that OpenRocket will give you a warning if you're going supersonic. I think it might actually give you a warning if you're even going transonic.
I think it also gives warnings for other problems, though, too, I've noticed.
Yeah. Fun fact, its simulations for supersonic flight are actually decent. LV2 went transonic, and the simulations were in very, very close agreement with the actual data.
Mm-hmm. I thought that LV2 actually went supersonic.
Nope, LV2 stayed transonic. So transonic is actually a pretty big range. Depending on the aircraft, it ranges from about Mach 0.8 to about Mach 1.2. And that range is defined by do you have flow around the vehicle that's supersonic in some places and subsonic in other places. So when you're all subsonic, you're in the subsonic regime. When you've got mixed flow going on, when you've got mixed regimes between sub and supersonic, then you're in transonic. And when you're entirely supersonic, then you're supersonic.
This repo is huge, man.
Yeah. thanks to SolidWorks, it's like over a gigabyte.
Yeah. I just cloned it without realizing.
Yeah. one time when we were driving down to California for the AIAA conference, I was like, oh shit, I don't have the LV2 repo on my laptop, and tried cloning it over, like, my cell phone. And it was like, oh, this is 1 kilobyte. It's going to take a month to complete. Oh my gosh.
you might exceed your data cap.
Yeah.
By a little.
Well, you know, you like half of it.
Where is the 4K file again?
Slash sim slash ORK.
Okay.
So you can have a whole bunch of simulation cases that use different motors. So you notice in this tab, I actually have a whole bunch of different motors, some of which are just empty. Sadly, and maybe you can correct me on this, but sadly, I think there's no way to do configurations of the airframe. You can only do configurations of just a motor and recovery. Does that sound right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I think you're right there, yeah. I haven't tried, but,
yeah. Yeah, I was poking around looking away to do configurations of the airframe, but I didn't find one. Because it would be really nice, like, for the different motor lengths, this gets switched between an 18 and a 24-inch module.
Mm.
It'd be really nice for the different motor lengths to automatically switch between that. But sadly, no.
Stages, I haven't actually gone over the tab, but that's probably not. That's for stage one, stage two, not for...
Yeah, I think that's just for sequencing the stages.
Hey, how do I correct these errors? Do I need to pull some libraries or something?
He has a different...
Yes,
something.
So...
Don't worry, that's a... When he set up, you won't have that one.
Oh, that's the one that the capstone team set up. Yeah.
So, you can go... So, OpenRocket has a whole bunch of thrust curves that define the motors. Like, define what's their thrust as a function of time, what's their mass as a function of time, what are the dimensions of the motor, what's its wet mass. Most of those come from this source, thrustcurve.org. And actually, almost all of, well, they don't appear right now for whatever reason. I made a bunch of cases where I was comparing different thrust curves of the same motor. So different people would publish their measured thrust curves. And long story short, either some people aren't measuring their thrust curves correctly, or some motors have a lot of variability. Maybe both.
Probably depends who makes it, right? Because, you know, batch.
Yeah.
It depends on the concentrations.
People are actually making these propellants themselves.
Yeah, you could. You have to think it's your L2. Once you get your L2, I think you can start actually mixing your own if you really want to. Mm-hmm. For the most part, we're not doing that. We're just doing commercial motors.
Yeah. I mean, we've kind of...
And what you guys have, right?
Well, I guess actually years and years ago, someone was trying to do a thing where they made like a hybrid attachment for solid motors.
Got it.
And that got abandoned because it was horrible. But I think Andrew has pushed the design tree of never develop your own solid motor, never develop your own hybrid because it's terrible and you can't scale it. And I kind of agree with that.
Funny is, you notice most universities are doing hybrids right now.
Yeah.
All the videos I see are all hybrids.
And it's dangerous.
Yeah.
One I just watched was Cal Poly, and they blew out their nozzle. So it just...
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I think it showed that one.
I saw it, yeah.
Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah, so the nozzle existed for maybe like a second, and then it just blows out, and then it just keeps running for a little bit. Although... I can see the benefit of the hybrids is they're cheaper. The one selling point, I think, but that's why a lot of universities are going for them. And they don't have such a well-developed group like we do. You know,
it's basically just adding throttling to a solid motor, kind of,
mm-hmm.
right?
Honestly, I think very few universities actually have as well-developed a group as we do.
Maybe if the instructors, it was instructor-led, and, you know, the instructors kind of lead the direction that each year students take, but the most part it's to teach the students so they kind of start from the very beginning.
Mm-hmm.
Well, anyone who wants to join us kind of has a little learning curve to catch up, but...
They do, but then once they get caught up, they're working on
their advanced, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it is nice having
although some knowledge
central thread people in the group.
Yeah. Those people who facilitate the knowledge transfer.
Yes. Yeah, Joe, how long are you planning on staying around?
I don't know.
Do you try not to think about it?
Yeah, pretty much.
We need to make some AIs that are the knowledge transfer.
This has repeatedly come up, really? That okay. Wouldn't it be so great if we could just clone the brain of a few people in PSAS?
Yeah, right.
Let's see. Building margin caliber. And move attack. And I'm actually just going to leave it like that. So, this is most likely what launch 13 is going to look like.
Insane O?
Yeah.
Okay.
So you'll notice that there's actually like interesting stuff happening in the stability curve, and it's starting at like half a caliber rather than a one caliber. this was a thing at the range last time where they're kind of like, "Eh, we wish you'd had one caliber," and. Yeah.
Oh yeah, you
nice.
Are. Huh. Okay. But you do get to one. Where's the? You don't have the launch rails thing on that.
Launch rail occurs right there.
Oh, right there. Okay.
Because that's where the plot starts.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Okay. So you're at 200 feet by the time you hit one. Yeah, or a little more than that, slightly.
Yeah.
Why one? Is it arbitrary?
Pretty much. It's a rule of thumb. What you'd actually do if you wanted to be like legit about the engineering is you'd say I've got some amount of variability in my thrust at launch and I've got some acceptable angle that it can take as its final trajectory. Assuming that I'm, you know, what, like two standard deviations away from the mean thrust at launch, and I've got some high, or yeah, assuming I'm two standard deviations away or something from the mean thrust at launch, what's the wind speed that would put me at the edge of that like acceptable angle, and then you'd measure the wind speed during the launch, and you'd have a go no go, mm-hmm. Or you know you'd wait for the wind to die down.
Do you have any idea what that wind speed is? Is that a parameter you can modify?
We can actually modify the wind speed.
In the setup, right?
Like not yeah. Analytically, but we can do it kind of guess and check wise. Mm. If we. Edit the simulation.
So you could basically create a couple different simulations. Each one would have a different wind speed, so you can kind of
yep.
Do what he's doing.
Totally.
Go, no go. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That'd be like a Python that you would want to automate.
Yeah. You could also just choose what your acceptable angle is and then plug in a few different wind speeds and build a table and then just interpolate it. Or at the launch site, measure the wind speed and plug it into your OpenRocket model and run it. Because it takes half a second to run.
Kind of what I remember some people doing, like that Nathan. Doing mm-hmm. That.
Oh, so am I supposed to find these guys and download them from that site?
Yeah. Although I would just ignore them, because
oh, right.
They're not that useful. Those, so when we were having the drama of
motors, okay.
Not having access to the motor we wanted, Andrew and I went into panic mode and looked at a bunch of different motors, and those were the different motors we were looking at.
There is no motor in this, so let's see, is there a way to... Oh, I see, never mind. So you can select it. Cool.
So
oh,
for an individual say, simulation,
oh, yeah. Sorry,
yes. It'll
yeah.
It'll switch the motor when you choose the simulation.
I see, okay. Simulation's insane.
Maybe that's not very...
The...
file I have doesn't have the launch rails and launch buttons.
It looks like you have an older version, so you need to pull.
I just downloaded it.
Older version of what? The file or the software?
The repo. Oh, it may be that this latest stuff is on DevJoe rather than on master.
Yeah, because mine only goes to 7.5.
No, that might be it, yeah.
This was 18 days ago.
Let me check what branch I'm on. So I'm on DevJoe, and master is a while ago. do you guys know how to use Git? You know how to use Git. You know how to use Git?
I should have been here last night.
Okay.
he's on mine. So,
I should put that stuff on master. I mean, if you wanted to download it, you'd select a different branch there.
This is 2,500 feet.
Yeah, so with the O motor, it does go real high.
Oh, are we using an O motor or a different one?
Yeah, we're going to have an O motor for this launch, which is super exciting.
Yeah, seriously.
What happened to the motor we were going to use?
We should all, bow down before William and give him many thanks for that. William.
Did you just buy it?
Yeah.
I thought he was an anonymous donor.
He's not anonymous now.
we already knew that it was him anyway.
You can edit the video if you want.
That's what Andrew said.
Go into the video and say, we should all praise John Doe.
Anonymous donor.
Thank you, anonymous donor.
Can you also do, can I see something?
So it's going to actually reach apogee
when you
load
a plot,
35 seconds. That's a long burn time.
For adding a new plot one, can you add...
6 minutes to get down? Of course, it doesn't have the dual deploy, probably.
It does.
Oh, it does?
I don't know if they're at the correct times and altitudes in the OpenRocket model, because I haven't really cared about when the parachutes deploy, as long as they do deploy.
Yeah, I'll let them go get it. It could be 10 miles away. It doesn't matter.
Yeah. I mean, really. I don't care if we have to trek over the desert for 10 miles, as long as it's in one piece.
You need Reynolds number. It's one of the things you can grab.
It's not going to be that informative of a metric. For LV3, at least. Because it's going to immediately go to crazy high numbers and then just go into places where you care more about long numbers.
I was looking at position. How far out, assuming that parachute that you set up is correct, how far out do you think it would actually land?
I think lateral distance would be what we actually want, because that's going to be distance from the launch site.
Yeah, try that. Because that would be interesting to see, especially if your wind's correctly set up.
So it's blue.
Did it just come back? Oh yeah, shoot deploy probably or something like that. Right? No deployments there.
So that's.
Recovery devices.
The main chute. And so.
Ground hit.
Ground hit, we're at. What? 2,000 feet.
Okay.
That's not bad. That's what? A third of a mile?
Somewhere.
Or two fifths of a mile?
Just shy of half a mile.
Oh, that's how far we'd have to track out to get it.
It's guessing about half a mile ish.
Let's also look at.
Of course, the winds can be a lot higher than. Yeah. But then you could run that.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
That's true. Let's look at the launch 12 data. Because certain motors will actually give you a really interesting.
You find sights
plot for stability margin caliber.
There's no way to set different winds for altitude.
Oh, wind is a function of altitude?
Yeah.
Yeah, wind is just a number.
So give the
some sort of average, sort of. Maybe if you do, you take into account like how long it would be in that section,
yeah,
and then
the
intensity
of
the those sections.
Useful thing for a lot of that is ground wind speed,
mm-hmm.
but.
Yeah, so if you look at like the stability margin for launch 12, it's so one thing going on here is I think the name for it is coning, where you have your rocket and it deviates a little bit, and the stability of the fins brings it back. But then momentum carries it forward to the other direction, and so it oscillates back and forth around its like average attitude. So that's what you're seeing here when the angle of attack does like this bouncing thing. Because it's
swinging back and forth.
Yeah,
angle
of attack has like an absolute value applied to it. At least for rockets. Oh yeah.
It's only like what, a quarter of a degree?
I think. There's some missile that does this. I don't know if we can find.
That jumps back and forth?
Yeah, that cones.
Intentionally.
I think it might be intentionally, yeah. So it can like sweep its sensors around.
Interesting, without having to make them, you know, mobile. Just move the entire fuselage.
I don't care about how you put it on the plane, just show me the engine. That doesn't help.
Well, I don't think you visibly see it.
Anyways, it's a thing. So that's what you're seeing when it bounces around like that. And that's also why you get kind of the scalloping in the stability margin caliber. Is you're getting different amounts of pressure on the nose cone or on the fins. And, you know, the reason the stability climbs up to something and starts low is the amount of stability that the fins add depends on how fast the rocket's going. Because if the fins have more air flowing past them, they're adding more stability. But you'll notice on launch 12, we actually started neutrally stable. Actually, let me check that it's got the right value for the launch rod. Put this in meters, that should be 4 meters. Yeah, that's 4 meters. That's another reason I switch between units a lot, is that rather than remembering some decimal, you know, so, yeah, for launch 12, the stability off the rail started at 0.3.
Oh. Okay.
And actually, it looks like it heavily depended on how fast the wind was blowing, because just now, without changing anything when I ran it, it showed negative margin. Because there, in the model, you can edit how much variation there is in the wind speed.
So that's just putting gusts in?
Yep.
Wind gusts.
So if we look at it now, it's starting with a little under 0.1 calibers.
Wow. Okay.
So this is why I'm totally not even worried about having half a caliber. Right?
Yeah. Well, then again, you had canards and stuff like that. You have the ability to actually stabilize it by spinning and stuff like that, right?
Except it didn't spin stabilize. And it didn't have the ability to control pitch or yaw. In fact, it was doing the opposite of spin stabilizing. It was trying to stabilize the angle.
Got it.
It was trying to stabilize the roll angle so the video would be clear.
Ah.
So it was the least spin stabilized it possibly could be.
So,
actually, you could do a plot of the roll, right? And then you could figure out like how much it would have to counter that, in a sense. Like, not it wouldn't be perfect,
yeah.
But you could look at it and go, oh, okay.
Get an idea of how much.
Yeah.
So with the RCS integrated in there, are you able to simulate that?
No. So you can't put in active control features into OpenRocket. So once we have the RCS and like thrust vector control, then things get more complicated. There's a thing called stability derivatives, which are basically the, what is the way to describe them? The rate of change of the moments, the torques on the airframe, as you tweak like the airspeed and the angle and stuff. So you want to get it so that those are forming like a little well that the system sits in, where if it deviates in one direction, it gets pushed back to stable.
Would it be outlandish to suggest, like over the course of this workshop, we've been talking about like, oh, OpenRocket doesn't do this, doesn't do that, but there should be a way to make it do that. Would it be outlandish to propose something like that as a project for computer science students for next year?
I don't think it would be outlandish. So the whole thing is open source, and it's all written in Java. So you totally could have, I mean, you'd want to like collaborate with the people who actually wrote it in the first place. I don't think it's under super duper active development right now. So I would guess that if we had a computer science capstone that wanted to extend OpenRocket, that they would be into it. I would imagine it wouldn't be just a computer science capstone, that you'd want people from either the electrical or the mechanical controls pathways in on that, because there's actual physics here.
Yeah.
It's not just back ends and front ends.
Right. It's a little bit more than just user experience.
Yeah.
There's also like an ME advisor or something like that.
Yeah.
Like, no, that's wrong. Don't do that.
There's actually, if you go to
like
contact,
the ideal would be
to
get
a whole get involved, like an exclamation mark. With
like
that,
some
so
master's student
like they,
that wanted to do control stuff that would do the control theory for LV3
aerodynamic competition methods
and have a CS capstone that took their ideas and implemented them in OpenRocket.
That makes sense.
I just wonder if that wouldn't be worth doing, especially as we progress towards LV4.
Yeah, I mean, we're going to have to address active stability.
Some of the paid software can handle?
Maybe. We can look at it.
I imagine like the most likely way it'll end up is that there'll be some purpose-built piece of code that's just for the stability of our rocket. That's going to be interesting convincing the range safety officers to let us fly when we have active stability and we can't even use the framework of center of pressure to talk about things.
Especially if they don't understand what you're talking about.
Right. So I imagine we're going to have to do like some scale model stuff to like justify what we're doing.
There might be that, or I wonder if we could just work with them to bring them in and talk about it in advance.
Yeah, that's correct.
But,
yeah, I imagine showing up with this
to
crazy
have simulations that you can show them in either case, saying, "So we've simulated this and we're sure that it works."
Coming back to the the fact that belief is a component of engineering.
It really is.
I don't see anything for it, unless you need a rock sim. The other thing about stability, but I don't think that's actually useful.
Have there been amateur rockets before that have had like active in-flight controls like this?
Copenhagen Suborbitals has thrust vectoring. I imagine somebody else has got to be doing it.
Is it the sort of thing where we'd want to go to NXRS for the first launch?
Maybe?
The RCS system.
I mean,
it sounds like OROC is more open to strange things launching.
They might even prefer us not to be at one of their public launches from that.
Right.
Just in case it turns into a kinetic missile.
The RCS is actually underpowered in pitch and yaw. Aaron was not confident that it would add any appreciable amount of stability. But that it would be able to control roll pretty well.
Up to a certain point, right? Cause then
pitch and yaw, sort of aerodynamic forces, and thrust would be dominant.
Okay, yeah, so I didn't see anything with that. But there might be software out there. I mean, I downloaded another one that I think I found that's free, but it's not great.
It's not an immediate problem. It just kind of occurred to me that that might be something we want to address.
Okay. Look at this one. I found this other simulation program, RAS Aero 2. It's not anywhere near like OpenRocket. Like, I was just curious. So, yeah, I can't do much. So. This is another little open software I found. Yeah, the nose cone, and whatever it is. Yeah, it's cute.
Not quite as many parameters.
No, not really. You can change the Mach number. Mach 5.
Oh, so it'll just, like, tell you stability at a particular speed?
Yeah. Actually, can you, like, partway? Yeah, so you can even do, like...
Let him wear a hat.
Right.
I think. Anything else?
I don't really have it.
3 o'clock.
Yeah.
That's a good point.
We've been here a good chunk of the day.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks for taking the time to come down here.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, that's cool.
Yeah, thanks for doing pretty much 2 workshops in a row.
I mean, it's nice to have other people who know how to do the things.
What?
We don't want to do it all yourself.